Would like to look tonight in Exodus chapter 5. I'm going to just read one verse of scripture dealing with Pharaoh here. It said, "And Pharaoh said, Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go." The question here that Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice?" And I think that's really a question that you hear a lot, that people would kind of state, "Who is the Lord? Why should I do that?" That's just in the Bible. Who are you? And a lot of time people say, you know, "Who are you?" And, you know, like they kind of said basically about Moses, "Who are you? Who do you think you are? Telling me what I ought to do. Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice?" I just want to look at a few things tonight that would kind of give us some thought of who the Lord is. And it's stuff that we know, I'm sure. But the first thing is, God, the Lord, is the creator. You know, we think about it, and that's one of the big problems. That's why they do not like, as it is, creation taught in the schools and throughout the land. I remember hearing one evolutionist speak on an occasion, and he said that that in essence, someone asked him out of the congregation or the college that he was at, and said, "Why or how is it that evolution took root so soon?" And he said, "Because of the morals. Because people didn't want anyone telling them," basically, he said in other words, but they didn't want anyone telling them what to do. If you have basically what he went on to say, if you have a creator, then that means he has a right to tell you what to do. So you think about who is the Lord? Well, he is the creator. He's the one that made you. You know, in John chapter 1, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Without him was not anything made that was made. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made." He is our creator. And I just want to, these are verses or thoughts that you know quite well, but it's very important that we think about, and I'm just going to go over a few things, but that why, who is the Lord that we should obey? Because there's plenty of people all the time telling you, you don't have to do that. That's just some old church teaching. This is the word of the Lord. He has the right to tell us. He has the right to tell us with our moral lives, with marriage, divorce. He has the right to tell a man that it's not lawful, it's not right for a man to marry a man or a woman, or for two people to live together. God has the right because he is the creator. And so we think about him being the creator, even in, I think, in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16 as well. Just listen to this verse in Colossians chapter 1. He is the creator. And the creator, he can tell what we should do and how we should live. We look in verse 17 of Colossians, it says, "And he is above all things." Now I'm going to back up in verse 16. It says, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth." Everything. You know, you can go out to the farthest distant planet, and God created. God made man. He created man, just like he said in his word. You know, a lot of time people say, I remember hearing Bill Nye speak a couple of years ago at on a video, and he said, well, a young lady asked him at the Creation Museum, said, "Why or where do you think man come from? If you don't believe man was created by God," he said, "Oh, they came from Mars." Well, you see, you know, it's a whole lot easier just to believe the word of God, that God created, and he created a man, and then he took the man or the woman out of the man, And we find that God has this right. See, he created a woman for a man. And this is how it's been since the beginning of time. And God is the creator. It says, for by him were all things created. That is God, everything. He comes on, he says, which are in heaven and in earth, visible and invisible. And so that takes everything that you want to think of. All of the things you can't even see now. Even with a microscope, there's more thing that we can't see, and yet God has made them all. And you know, you think that you get to the smallest thing that there is, and then they find out all the time, no, there's something smaller. And then you think about this vast domain throughout this galaxy in which we're in, and that's just a little speck throughout all of space. God created planet after planet after planet, and you know, it's kind of like people say, well, why would he create this? Now, I'm a firm believer that there are no Martians out there. You can show them to me when they come. But I believe that God created. He created man in all of it. This is the apple of his eye. This is, a lot of time people say, well, you know, there's if there's a create, you know, if you've never seen one, you couldn't say that there's not any. Well, I don't believe that square Bob square pants or whatever is a live being, and I even see cartoons of him. So you know, I have no doubt. I'm 100% convinced that there are no little green men. The Lord Jesus Christ is creator. I believe there's angels, and I believe that angels have been involved, that God has sent forth ministering spirits into this earth, and I think that you see that over and over, is that God has sent down angels to minister. But we have, as it is, we have a creator. He made. And I have no problem with thinking about this universe of being empty and no one sees it but God. Just like people say, why would God plant a flower in the wilderness that blooms and no one sees it? I'm going to tell you, God sees it. He's the creator. And he comes on here and he says, whether they be thrones or dominion or principalities or power, governments, and all things were created by God. And he says here, by him and for him. That is, everything exists for him. And he comes on, he says, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And we know the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit work together. They say, let us make man in our image. Now we find in Revelation, and this will be the last thought dealing with creation, but in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11, listen to this here. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. He said everything that exists is for God's pleasure. Now, brethren, I'm going to tell you, whether you see it or not, all of this stuff that's been invisible to us, it's been for the pleasure of God. God sees, God knows, God is the creator of it all. Every planet out there that nobody has ever seen, every star, every galaxy, all of the things that go on that are amazing, and we're just starting to see some of them. There's still more stuff that goes on and on and on. There's trillions of stars. It's almost an endless amount. They're all created for the glory of God. He's the creator. He's the one. So you see, God is the creator. You might say, who is the Lord? The Lord Jesus Christ is the creator. Who is the Lord? He is the creator. He's the one that has made us, and not we ourselves. We're the creation of his hand. You know, because he's our creator, so he has a right to tell us what to do. And not only the right, he knows the right way. He knows the way that will bring pleasure. I remember hearing this one liberator speak, this woman, years back, and I wish I would have wrote her name down, but she, radio or whatever, but she said, in essence, she said all of her life, she she was telling people, she was in her 60s, she said, I've been telling people all my life, you didn't need a man. You didn't need to have children. And she said, now I'm in my 60s and all I really want is to have a husband and to have children. She said, and now it's too late. I'm going to tell you, God has. Now, I'm not saying that God can't give peace to a woman and not marrying, or a man and not marrying and bless them in ways, but the overall way of God is that it's not good for man to be alone. It's that God has designed a man and to be with a woman and to have holy matrimony, and not the way of this world. They dirty up everything out there. God has ordained the relationship in holy matrimony. It's a holy thing. The bed's undefiled. God, it's not dirty. But when the world dirties it up and all this perversion and all this garbage that you see in pornography and all of these movies with the dirt, the trash, the filth, you see, they turn something that God created and it was good, and they turn it into something evil. And yet we find that God is the creator. He's the maker. He's the one that made every one of us. He's the one that created every one of us. He's the one that has the right to tell us how we're to live our lives. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not bear false witness. He has all of the right in all of the commandments of God that he tells us whether one, and that's what's amazing. The law of God has been out there for whether one is a believer or not. These are basic moral laws in our society. So we need to understand when somebody says, who is the Lord? Or who are you? Well, I'm a servant of the Lord, and all I'm doing is just trying to tell people about the Word of God and what the Bible says, because my God is the Creator. There was nobody that just sprung into being creation. In fact, as the old saying goes, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist, because there's too much of creation, too much of miracle, too much amazing thing for anything to evolve. Nothing you see in society or in our universe or in our planet was just popped into existence. God created. Another thought I had is that in Jeremiah chapter 18, you know, you think about God is the creator. Well, he's also the potter. You know, that a potter is really a creator. I remember doing a little pottery work when I was a child. None of it's left. None of it was very valuable. I don't even think if I gave anything to Mama, I don't think that they are still around. But nonetheless, the pottery, you know, the potter has power. You can make all kind of things out of that clay. And of course, he was dealing here with Israel in this particular chapter. And he says in chapter 18, and he says in verse 6, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in my hand, O house of Israel. At what instant I shall speak concerning a nation. Okay, you want to think about nation? God bless this nation to be in existence. And he blessed our founders. They were just like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They had their failures as well. But they were men that loved God, men and women that laid down their lives, that we're experiencing the freedom that we have today. And they did it not to have freedom to be able to just live their lives out like they wanted to. They did it that they would have freedom to worship God. That was their main goal. You know, that's not really promoted and talked today, but they really desired the Lord Jesus Christ. Even all the colleges, the pagan colleges, the old ones of today, you'll find on their cornerstones, or at least in their history, you will find that they were established for the furtherance of the gospel of the kingdom of God. That is, they were made because they wanted people to be educated to where they could read and study the Bible, not like the paganism of today, that they want people to be educated past intelligence to where God no longer means anything. God no longer is of any value to them. But God is as well is the potter. And we find he says, at what instant He says in verse 7, "At what instant I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to pluck up, to pull down, to destroy it. If that nation against whom I have pronounced turneth from their evil, I will repent of the evil that I thought to do unto them. And at what instant I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to build and to plant it, if it do evil in my sight, that it obey not my voice, then I will repent of the good wherewith I said I would benefit them." And basically he goes on to say that he'd destroy them. Now I want to tell you, brethren, is that God, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? The Lord is the potter. And our nation, this church, right now Primitive Baptists have gone really bad. Well, I find that it's not just Primitive Baptists. I find as a rule out there, the majority of churches have gone just really away from God, living behind good time religion and not really following the Word of God. And so we have all this feel-good stuff. Yeah, we ought to feel good. Yeah, we ought to rejoice in the Lord. But I want to tell you, there's more to it than that. It's obeying. Who is the Lord? And I've had people, I've been to a pile of our churches, and I've had people over and over say, "We can't do that. We can't follow the Word of God. We're not going to do that." And that's what you have here. If people don't listen to God, and if I, and it don't matter if you follow the Lord for a long time, if we turn our back on God, God says, at what instant I bring up a nation, at what instant I bring up a church, at what instant I bring up a people or a person or a family, God can bring it down. And people say, "Well, who is the Lord?" He is the Lord. He is the potter. He's the one that has your very breath in his hand. You know, you think about the only reason any of us are living today, because God has kept us. Don't you think Satan would desire to snuff out our lives? But just like he had a hedge about Job, he has a hedge about you. Several of you have come close to dying on a lot of different occasions, several occasions. And every one of us, I tell you what, you're a sneeze away from death, going up and down the highway. But God is the potter. God is the one in control. But God has the right, any of us, all of us, he has the right. He has the right to just, you know, whether physically or whether if we disobey him, he has the right to. He don't need Primitive Baptists. He don't need Baptists. He don't need America. God will have people glorify. If we cease to glorify him, the rocks will glorify him. And I believe that literally. I believe the heavens declare the glory of God. Nature itself declares the glory of God. Well, if we cease, I tell you, he raised up the Gentiles, which we are. But brethren, I believe literally the rocks, you know, as I think about the stars, I think about all the sounds in space. Oh, I want to tell you, it's all to the praise and the glory of God. We think, you know, of course, you could think about Jacob and Esau. Now, whether you view that as dealing with eternal election, or you think of it as between Israel and so forth, the Gentile, or, you know, or whatever, we find that God loved Jacob and hated Esau. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. Now, it goes on down in that passage, dealing with a little more depth, and I want to look at that as well. Who is the Lord? I'm going to tell you, the Lord, he's the one that chose me. He's the one, he is the creator, and he's also, as we think about it, the one that chose me. Let me deal with that. The one that blesses. He has the right to do what he wants. In Romans chapter 9, we find that he says here, in verse 11, it said, "For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God?" I'm going to tell you, just like we think about God blessing one nation and not another, God, you know, you think of America, you think of nations down through history. God has a right to do what he will. He has a right to bless an individual, one person. You know, God loved me, and the only reason I can say that he loved me, now this will be going right in, another reason that I can say who is the Lord that I should obey him, not only is he my creator, but he is my savior. And that's really, they're really kind of, you could say, together, because when you think of it in this way, just as the evolutionists say that there was something out there. I want to tell you, God created everything from nothing, and you know, it's just like if the people came from Mars, well, where did those people come from? You know, they could say, well, Venus. Well, where did they come from? You know, it's a never-ending thing. There had to be a beginning in creation, and there was. It was God. God has always been. God's always been there, and God spoke the world into existence. He made, and there was not a little bit of dust out there. There was nothing. And the same is true in dealing with a new birth, is that there wasn't just a little bit of good out there, I mean, in me. There was nothing. When Adam sinned, the Word of God made it plain that when he sinned, I died. All of us died in Adam. We were dead men. And you have to be quickened in Ephesians chapter 2 and 1, you have to be quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin. You were dead. You had not the ability to be able to help yourself. That's why you have to be born again. You know, whenever throw out the lifeline, when he threw out the lifeline, he didn't throw it to a live man. He the lifeline was his hand that he grabbed me and yanked me, as it was, out of the very pit of hell. He is the one that grabbed me. I was a dead man, and he gave me life and all that. That's why the new birth, you know, it's plain in John chapter 3 that in the new birth that you have to be born again to see the kingdom. You have to be born again to enter the kingdom. And in John chapter 1, we find in verse 13 where he said, which were born not of blood, that is, it don't matter about your lineage, which were born not of blood, nor the will of flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. You're born again by the will of God, totally by his sovereign grace, his sovereign will. And now in verse 11 of chapter 1 of John, he makes it plain that we're to receive Christ, we're to receive his teaching, we're to receive, acknowledge him as the Messiah, but the only one that can do that is a born again, alive child of God that has life. And so why should I listen to his voice? Why should I obey him? It's because he has the right. He's the potter. He's the creator. He made me. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. He created me out of nothing, and he loved me because he wanted to. In fact, as we find in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9, who saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. God did it because he said, I wanted to. He said, you're mine. You're mine. So none of us can talk about, oh, when I get to heaven, I'm going to get up there, and I'm going to find that person that caused me to be born again. No, when I get to heaven, I want to tell you, all I care about is King Jesus, because he is the one that caused me to be born again. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, and that being the Lord Jesus Christ, born of him. We're born of his seed and his seed alone. Now, we find, and I want to go ahead down in Romans 9, in the verse I was reading, I think I touched on, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. God is not unrighteous. You know, in Romans 5, it lays out that we were dead, saved while we're dead men and women. We're redeemed. And then we find in Romans chapter 6, he said, what shall we continue in sin that grace might abound? God forbid. That is, you know, we're not, that is not the calling that he's done. He hadn't saved us to continue in sin. He saved us to come out of sin. And the problem is, as Paul said, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? You know, your death, your body, it keeps coming alive because your body don't want to die easy. One day it shall physically, and then it's going to put on a new body, a new life. But until now, I'm not saying you got to kill yourself physically, but in a sense, there's a death. I die daily. You have to crucify yourself. You have to die. You have to continue. Now, there was some old scary movie out years ago. I don't watch scary movies, even when I was living for the devil. I sure wasn't going to watch anything about the devil, because of Freddy Krueger or any of them, that they kept coming back alive. They'd kill them, and the next movie they'd be alive again. And so, you know, you don't... the problem is, you die once, you come down the aisle, you do what's right, you begin to serve the Lord, you don't stay dead. It's a daily thing that you have to put on off this flesh and put on the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to have the mind of Jesus. And the problem is, you know, it's kind of like the old statement, or as John the Baptist said, he must increase, I must decrease. Some days there's more of Jesus in my life, and then other days you'll find more of me. There's more of me to rub somebody's bald head, as sometimes I do. There's more of me that will speak things that I ought not. There's more of me that I act like I ought not. In other days, there's more of Jesus. Our whole guide, our whole way should be more of Jesus, more about Jesus, more of Him, more love to Thee, serving Him, putting off me. So He must increase in my life, and I must decrease. And I'm going to tell you, that's our total goal in life, should be, I want people to see Jesus in my life. So why should I obey His voice? He's the potter. We find here, He's my creator spiritually, and He's my literal creator. He comes on down here, and He says here, what verse 15 of chapter 9, for He said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then it's not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. The scripture said to Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power. Well, I want to tell you, brethren, God showed His power. Yes, He raised up Pharaoh, even for that same purpose. He said, that I might show my power. He says here, for the scripture saith, Pharaoh, even for this same purpose I have raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore He hath mercy on whom He hath mercy, and whom He will He hardeneth. Thou wilt say then unto me, why doth he yet find fault? Who hath resisted his will? Nay, but O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power of the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? What if God, willing to show His wrath, to make His power known, endure with much long suffering the vessel of wrath fitted to destruction? I'm going to tell you, that's pretty plain right there. And He says, in that He might make known the riches of His glory on the vessel of mercy, which He had afore prepared unto glory. I'm going to tell you, brethren, and of course He says that not only of the Jews, but the Gentiles also. Brethren, is why should I obey His voice? Now, even the heathens, in one sense, should, that because He's Lord, but there are people that live like they want, according to the Psalms, is that David was real upset. You know, he done wrong, he got chasing all the day long. Other people did wrong, they did what they wanted, they could live like the devil, and nothing happened. Well, I'm going to tell you, when David went to the house of the Lord, he understood therein. There are those that can live any way they want, and yet God's people, among all denominations out there, God's people, when we live and we go contrary to the Word of God and live like we want to live, there are great consequences in our life. David said, I'm chasing all the day long. David suffered hell in his life. Though God forgave them and tempered it with mercy, the story Lord never departed from his life because he looked on a woman one day and he lusted after her, and then he had her. He went and had her brought to him, and we find that, why should I obey the Lord? I'm going to tell you, he's my creator. He's the one that caused me to be born again. He, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. I'm going to tell you, and by the way, that word world, if it was the sin of the world, literal, then brethren, everybody's going to be in heaven. But I believe that world, just like all the world was taxed, it was used the Roman Empire, all the world was taxed, it was talking about the worlds of God's people. And so we find that God loved his people. And we find here that, behold, the Lamb of God. I'll read one other verse, that he is our Savior, you see. That's why I ought to give everything I have for him. I ought to live. I ought to be willing to lay my neck down. I ought to be willing to honor him with my money, with my substance, with my life, with my mind, with my eyes, with my hands, with my feet. I ought to give everything to him. And we find, as in Hebrews chapter 9, I believe it is, in verse 11, it said, but Christ being come in high priest. Now, he's my high priest. He's the one that offered the sacrifice. He did it by his own blood. He don't have to enter into the high place any longer. By one offering, he's perfected forever them that are sanctified. He says here, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, one time, having obtained eternal redemption for us. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? You see, we ought to serve him because he is our Savior. He saved me, and he continues to save. We experience salvation in our life when we call out to him. He says he saves us to the uttermost. That is, we don't have to live down here in these bodies in a corruptible lifestyle. He said, who shall deliver me from the body of this flesh? This is why God's people need to hear the gospel. They need to be filled with the Spirit. We need to have the Spirit of God. We need to understand, as he says, he's given us the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of the glory of his grace. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. He's given us this earnest of the Spirit, this down payment. We have heaven now. We have a piece of it today. So who should I listen to? Why should I obey him? Who is his voice? I'm going to tell you, he is, as we said, my creator. He is physical creator, the creator of the universe, the creator of all things, and he is my spiritual creator. He created a new man in me. He gave me life spiritually. And then we find he is my Savior, and all of that is connected together. But he's my Savior. He's my Lord. That's the next thought we could look at, is that, remember, he tells us as well in his word that he is also our Lord and Savior. You know, people a lot of times love to listen. We love to think about God being my Savior. You know, he bought me. He paid for me. He paid it all. I love that. All to him I owe. And yet, I want to tell you, not only is he my Savior, but he's also my Lord, which means supreme ruler. Remember, Peter said on the day of Pentecost, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that same Jesus whom you crucified is both Lord. And so, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? He is the Lord. He is the King. The King of Kings. We find that in a lot of passages, and I'm not going to just go over too many to beat it down. 1 Timothy 6 and 15, I believe it is, where he says, which in times past he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate. You know, there, I realize the potentate, as you think of, there are those in different organizations that have, you know, potentates, but the supreme ruler, is Jesus. None of these other things, you don't need to ever be a part of a secret organization that has a potentate and that don't allow praying in the name of Jesus. That, you know, all of these organizations, a lot of good people are a part of them. But nonetheless, we find that Jesus is the only potentate. And he said, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's in Revelation a lot. He is the King. So who is the Lord? He's the King. He's the only potentate. He's the Prince of Kings, it says in one place. So now you have all these scriptures. Why should I obey him? Why should I listen to him? Well, I want to tell you, for God's people, is that he is certainly creator. He's creator of those that are not. But he's the creator, and he's your spiritual creator. He's the one that's given you life. He is as well not only your creator, but he is your savior. You know, as in Matthew 1 and 21, she shall bring forth a son, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people. So he's your creator, and then we find he is your king. He's your Lord. So as you think about this, just keep in your mind, he is the potter. He has the right. He has the right to do with you what he will. Some people live to be 100, 102. And some of them are very angelic at that age. But nonetheless, some, they die early. You know, I can't understand that. Some in the womb. Why? How come? Why should that be? We're born in America. Why? You know, people that have a problem with grace, sometimes I say, look, if you think about it in time, why did you have the parent that you had? Why are you born in a nation where you got Bibles all over the place? Most of the world were born in a nation before there was TV, before there was radio, before there were anything. It's only the people they heard. A lot of them born in tribes and in places in Africa and in Mexico, in a lot of places that, you know, among the Inca Indians in South America and so forth, that they didn't have the benefits that we have. And in all of the things we have, why on earth did God bless me to be born here? I should never exalt myself. I should realize that I'm indebted to God. And so, you know, we don't know why. How come he blessed us? Why he blessed us to be a part of this nation? Why most of the world is not? Why we have plenty when many people are starving? I want to tell you, God can do what he will. And we need to be praying and encouraging other people. We need to be ministering to other people. But brethren, whenever somebody asks you or when the thought comes to you, just remember some of these things. Why should I obey the Lord? Why should I obey his word? Well, he is indeed my creator. He is indeed the potter. He is indeed my king. He is my savior. So yes, that's why I should obey the Lord. I owe it all to Jesus. Whenever there's something that we need to stand on, if it's to choose between the individual and it's to choose between God, it's always God, or it should be in my life and your life. We ought to love people, minister to people, care for people, but we should stand up for Jesus. God bless you, that as you hear these questions, who is the Lord? Who are you? I'm just servant of the Lord. I'm a nobody. But he has exalted you and me to the position to declare his word. Because I want to tell you, what he has to say is really for the good of all humankind in the standpoint of how to live and things we ought to do. So I pray the Lord to help you and me, not to back up, but help us to realize who is the Lord. He's my creator. He's my potter, the one that made me spiritually and naturally. He's my king. And certainly, he's my Savior. God bless you and me to honor him with our lives. For Christ's sake is my prayer. Brethren. Amen.